AM 560, The Answer.
Listen to AM 560, The Answer, online at 560theanswer.com, on the AM 560 mobile app, on your Alexa-powered smart speaker, and on TuneIn, iHeart, and on Odyssey.
Dan and Amy, top of the morning, remembering Meatloaf this morning. I got to tell you, as a fan of the opera, I loved his dramatic operatic performances and the videos, too, especially the videos associated with Bat Out of Hell 2 that came out in 93. Like, I Would Do Anything for Love, which we'll get to, was just one of the great videos of all time that meld between Beauty and the Beast and Phantom of the Opera. But I digress. Dominic Green, who's coming up next, is... a man of culture and letters and the arts. Maybe he'll have some comments on that as well. But first, we played young woman from across the pond there, Merry Old England, yesterday. And let's play her again because her comments deserve to be heard many times. This is a student in England named Sophie Corcoran, who was on a news program in Britain when Bojo took to the floor of the House of Commons and announced that COVID was over in England. And here was her reaction, young Sophie. Do we have Sophie? Where's Sophie?
Obviously, this comes as a brilliant bit of happiness for me. I don't actually think I can stop smiling when I'm talking. It's about time. Obviously, you just said earlier, the one that makes me the happiest is the face masks in schools. There was zero evidence for those face masks to be in schools. There have been studies that show that because of the types of face masks that we, because I'm going to say we, because I was in schools when all of these policies were enacted, the face masks that we would have are not medical grade face masks, therefore they would make no difference to transmission. But what I found out when I was in the classroom, and most commentators have never been able to speak on this because they quite frankly didn't experience it, so you can hear it from me the first. There were teachers that were sitting there that would, you know, be yelling at the poor year sevens about their face masks more than they would be teaching them. Those shy kids that would sit at the back of the class that would never speak, it was a massive barrier to them to impact their learning. They were already terrified, didn't want to speak out, and now they've got another barrier to engaging their learning. Communication problems were impossible. I'm going to be honest with you, most of the time when we were in school, we took them off because we couldn't hear each other. They couldn't hear us, we couldn't hear them. You're in schools to learn, and the damage that they have done to my generation has been unbelievable. Like, I sat there in August.
The damage what's done?
That they've done to the rest of our lives, to our education. I sat there in August and literally watched my future crumble in front of my eyes.
Tell me why.
Well, they cancelled my exams. So I got my exams cancelled once, went back and thought, no, you know what, this is not on. I'm not getting screwed over by the algorithm. I'm better than this. Got there, they cancelled them again, and I thought, nothing I can do anymore. So this makes me so angry. It literally ruined our life. And nobody spoke about it at all. And the commentators, they had union reps come on and say, this is what the school should have put in place. And they didn't care about what this did to us. And this is the first time I've ever spoken about it on TV because I knew that I'd cry about it. But I literally watched and felt like my entire life was falling apart because of what this government did to young people. And nobody cares. Not one person has cared about children in this pandemic. They think, oh, let's throw... Why are we putting masks on them when people can go to football stadiums and they can go to theatres and play... Nadeem Zahawi sitting there at the teaching awards with no mask, and yet we're disrespecting kids. This pandemic will finish. The damage this has done for us is forever, and we'll never get it back.
For more on this, we're pleased to be joined by the aforesaid Dominic Green. He's the editor of the Spectator's World Edition. Dominic, thanks for joining us. Appreciate it.
Good morning, Dan. Good morning, Amy. What a shocker to hear that. I have to say, I wasn't prepared at all.
I
still cry. I watched it three times and it makes me cry every time because everything she said is true.
When you listen to someone like Sophie Corcoran and other young people who've spoken out about this at school board meetings and the like, it's almost like listening to a person who has been victimized give their victim impact statement in court before the criminal is sentenced?
Yeah. Well, at every stage, the policy that governments, not just in the US, but also in Europe and elsewhere, we put the needs of the elderly ahead of the young. And that's a difficult decision for any government to make. But it's worth noticing that if we fail to educate a generation of children and traumatize them, then we're not doing ourselves any favors in the long term. And I'm delighted to hear that Britain has led the way in getting rid of these ridiculous theatrical masking rules. One of the things that worried people about COVID because of its obvious lab origins was, what if they were able to develop a virus that only targeted specific people? Well, we seem in the US to have a virus that targets people according to their political affiliations, because if you're in a red state, you don't need to wear a mask. Mm-hmm. But this virus is apparently uniquely dangerous to people who live in blue states, and we're still masking children in them. We're still, I mean, here in Boston, there's a mandate now, you have to show your vaccine status in order to go into a shop. It is absolutely ludicrous. It is completely unscientific. It is costing us money. It is traumatizing people. It is dividing people from each other and people from their governments. And the longer this absurdity goes on, the worse it'll go.
Well, so what happened with Boris Johnson? Is this in reaction to Partygate? Is that the reason why on next Thursday everything's dropped and COVID is officially over?
Well, as you know, Boris Johnson is a man of the highest principle. And who am I to speculate that there might be a possible connection between the fact that his political career has gone face down in the last few days because of these revelations that, and in Britain, there were some serious lockdowns there, much worse than here, even in the bluest of blue states in the US. And I was there through one of them, and I have to say it was grueling. And it's now come out that, Friday night, the staff in Downing Street were carrying in suitcases of booze and having private parties. And even the night before the funeral for Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh, and we all saw the famous photos of the Queen sitting on her own, observing the COVID rules, at the funeral in the chapel at Windsor. And meanwhile, the Prime Minister and his chums were sinking them at the desks. And of course, Boris is saying no one told him this wasn't a work do, but no one believes that. This is symbolic, I think. There's going to be consequences for the way these things have been handled. We will eventually find out about the origins. We will eventually find out how many people died from COVID rather than with COVID. We'll find out how many of those people were over the average age of death anyway, and how many of them had serious and possibly fatal conditions anyway. All of this will shake out in time. And one of the things we'll find out is about the masks and whether, dealing with something like Omicron, whether they are purely theatrical. And the chances are, and I believe, that it is theater, and it is a political theater.
You know, when the epitaphs of some of these COVIDian politicians are written, I can't help but think of Winston Churchill's remarks on the passing of Prime Minister Stanley Baldwin, who, of course, he loathed and he blamed for Germany being able to, essentially position itself in the run-up to World War II. He said when Stanley Baldwin passed that, I'm sorry that he passed, but it would have been better had he never lived. And I honestly, with respect to the damage that has been done, these COVID and particularly with the COVIDian politicians that persist in spite of the science and data and anything resembling common sense, I'm wondering if that's not an appropriate epitaph for some of them.
Well, I think we're going to see them passing quite soon. I think if you look at Joe Biden's numbers and you look at Boris Johnson's numbers, the next time the electorates get a chance to comment on the policies that have been imposed on us in the last 2 years, I'm afraid that they're all going to find that they are actually going to be accountable. Because at the moment, they're doing their best to dodge and to keep the panic going. And it's unacceptable. Well, on the subject of passings, I just want to note, if, as you say, I am a man of culture, it is because I was exposed to Meatloaf at a young age. Hmm. The first grown-up concert that I attended, I was 13 years old and saw him at the Hammersmith Odeon in London. And I'm still recovering from it. It was absolutely tremendous.
He was just such a theatrical artist. It was a pleasure, and also this, you know, the longevity too, which is a tribute to any artist to bat out of hell one in the late 70s to come back almost two decades later, and in my estimation, do it even better the second go round.
But he was literally larger than life, and he had not just personality but amazing chops. I mean, musical chops.
Yes.
He to sing like that. I mean, when you look at people in music these days, they're small figures. They don't tend to have this incredible presence. There was some, as you said, something like operatic about it, but sort of Wagner mixed with like both early and late Elvis.
Yeah.
You know, it was the true spirit of rock and roll mixed with all this other stuff. And of course, Jim Steinman's songs were incredible songs. In fact, on the Bat Out of Hell recording, he also had most of Bruce Springsteen's band on that record, too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're right. The songs are just epic. They're like,
the performances.
The songs, too, they're like epic poems. You know, not some bubblegum pop song. They're like epic stories.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So I'll be playing Meatloaf this afternoon.
Oh, yeah. Dan, may I ask one question about Prince Andrew, please? Because I know how you love the royal family.
Yeah, Randy Andy.
Yeah, well, Twitter account deleted. He lost his military title. So obviously they're bracing for something horrific to happen, don't you think?
Yes, and I think he needs to answer these questions. There is, you know, we've all seen the evidence. We've all read it. We've seen the photos. And there has been the criminal conviction in the case of Ghislaine Maxwell. It is very obvious that he has hung out with the wrong people and seems to have enjoyed it rather too much. And the sooner that he speaks to the US authorities, the better. It's absolutely outrageous that he's able to hide from them. And the fact is this, if he was Mr. Andrew Windsor, the British police would have put him in irons, put him on a plane at Heathrow, and he would be in the US now facing these questions. So he may have taken away his royal title, but he's still the Duke and he's still got these privileges. And I think it's disgraceful that the British police are doffing their caps and tugging their forelocks as if this is the Middle Ages and somehow he's beyond the law. He's not.
One more question before we get back to Meatloaf's music. Joe Biden's presser the other day and his discussion about the West's response to any invasion of Ukraine by Putin, did that inspire a lot of confidence among Bojo and the political class there?
I think the political class in Britain are absolutely, they're almost as befuddled as the president is. In Britain, as in elsewhere, they are struggling to understand what it is that the US wants to do. You know, when it came to the withdrawal last summer from Afghanistan, it was understood, well, at least they want to get out. But here we are, we're going in, we're going forward into a crisis. And Biden's presser, to me, he sort of thought aloud and gave away exactly where the threshold is that Putin can go to in order to get away with it without serious consequences. And Biden should not have said this. This is a big mistake to give it away like that. The world knows that the U.S. is not going to fight Russia. It would be insane to fight Russia on its own doorstep. On the other hand, what can we do to stop the peace of Europe disintegrating? And unfortunately, this administration has given a green light to Putin to nibble away, not just at the territory of Ukraine, but at the foundations of the international order. And no good will cover this. And in Europe, it's now every man for himself. There is no unity at all in this. Germany is playing it very quietly because they need Russian gas. Britain is no longer has a voice, of course, in the European Union and has been sending weapons to Ukraine. France will go its own way. At a moment when we need the U.S. to lead more than ever, there is literally an incoherent response coming out of Washington. So I think this bodes very badly indeed.
He is Dominic Green. He's the editor of the Spectator's World Edition. And Dominic, this one's for you.
Into hell and back. I would do it.
Thank you.
Dominic Green, join us on the turnkey.pro answer line. Thanks, Dominic.
And he joined us on our turnkey.pro answer line.
won't do that.
Before you see it on TV, share it on Facebook, or read about it in the paper, hear it here first. This is Chicago's Morning Answer on AM 560. The Answer.
Balance of Nature's fruits and vegetables in a capsule. Changing the world one life at a time.
I drive a truck for a living, and I'm gone every week, all week long, and I know I don't eat right. And it really helps a lot. It's awesome. I'll never stop taking it.
I feel more energetic. And I think as you keep taking it, the better you get, the better you feel with it. And I'm a truck driver, so I need that energy. And I feel the energy.
Balance of Nature is working great. Lost 24 pounds. My muscles are good. It's so much easier now getting in and out of that truck. I'm not sore. It's just amazing. I'm really happy with the product.
Experience the Balance of Nature difference for yourself. Right now, Balance of Nature is offering free shipping and 35% off on any new preferred order. Call 800-246-8751. That's 800-246-8751. Or by going to balanceofnature.com. And make sure to receive this special radio offer by using discount code Chicago.
All right, I have some information to share that's relevant for many of you. Do you own a term life insurance policy? If so, you might want to know that you can convert all or part of your own term life policy into a permanent plan that could give you level premiums for life without any health questions or medical exam. It's easy to see if you're eligible, and the consultation is free. Just call our friends at Life Quotes. Their helpline number is 800-640-5433. That's 800-640-5433.
A while back, we at AmericanEagle.com were asked to build the e-commerce site of a major candy distributor. With the need for a website that could take into account everything from shipping times to local weather, because, you know, candy melts, the task was not like taking candy from a baby. Fortunately, we live for a good digital challenge and free bonbons. So we got to work on a slew of complex integrations, including a shipping algorithm that factored in variables like distance, speed, and location. The website even let the end customer personalize their candy for special events, like weddings or